Hi guys, this is Dr. Patil, your medicine educator for an academy. Those who don't know me, let me tell you that I am a practicing internist, and in the last couple of years I am dedicated to teaching, and I have been covering medicine as my subject on an academy platform. Okay, now today I am recording this video. This is not a live session, so probably I will not be able to directly respond to your queries on the comment section, but you can find my Telegram channel, which is known as Dr. Patil's MedMania. And if you have any queries, you can definitely shoot it there, Dr. Patil's MedMania for NEET PG, and I will be more than happy to address them. Okay. Now, there is a particular reason why I am recording this video, because when I was doing live sessions, I did realize that a lot of students find it difficult to assimilate concepts that are important in medicine. Now, in general medicine, being a subject where we kind of amalgamate information coming from all other subjects like basic sciences, applied or para sciences, and then finally put it together to call it as medicine. General medicine is not a subject per se, right? If the concepts are not clear, the problem is that we have to make a lot more effort to remember the concepts as facts. Now, medicine is a subject which is loaded with facts that we need to remember. And if you convert all concepts into facts, then medicine becomes a giant subject. So at least let me take the pain of simplifying the concepts for you so that it is no longer a pain for you. Okay. So in this space of YouTube, you will be able to find all the conceptual videos that I'm going to record henceforth parked. So you can come to the YouTube, go to this conceptual medicine section, and you will be able to find all these conceptual videos. The first video I'm recording is about aphasia. Apart from that, soon you will be able to get videos about apraxia, then various other neurological conceptual videos. Then you will be able to see conceptual videos about clinical approach to a case of polyuria, altered electrolyte abnormalities, all that from a little bit of conceptual perspective rather than just trying to follow the old bookish method of classification and a flowchart kind of approach. Okay, so the first disease that we're talking today is about aphasia. Now, when I say aphasia, what does that mean? Basically, I'm talking about a disorder of speech, right? Now, when we say aphasia, we guys already know that there are different types like Broca's aphasia, Wernicke's aphasia. We call Broca's as motor. We call Wernicke's as sensory aphasia. Then we have an intermediary called conduction aphasia. These three things I'm pretty sure that you're all very familiar with. But then we have also other types of aphasia. So one of that is transcortical, anomial, and pure word deafness. Now, if we understand these aphasias conceptually, trust me, you can tackle any kind of MCQ that is asked about these. Okay, so I will tell you how do we approach that. So let us start with aphasias. We know these two aphasias very, very well, right? Broca's and Wernicke's. So whenever I ask students, what do you mean by Broca's aphasia? They will tell two things. Sir, it is motor aphasia, and where the understanding of what other person is speaking is preserved. Good. If this much understanding you have, right, the foundation is set. Now, whenever I ask about Wernicke's aphasia, they say that patient is able to speak well, but he doesn't understand what is being spoken to him. Fair enough. That is like a solid understanding of the concept. Okay. So, whenever we approach an aphasia, we have to look at these four domains. And whenever you get an MCQ, these four domains will be given to you. The information about these four domains will be given to you. And if you're seeing a patient, well, obviously you have to gather the information about these four domains as the physician. Okay, what are the four domains I'm talking about? I'm talking about fluency, comprehension, repetition, and naming. Fluency, comprehension, repetition, and naming. Now, what do I mean by fluency? Fluency in a dictionary meaning means fluent, or you can say something that flows without gaps and breaks. So when I say the speech is fluent, that means the patient is able to talk continuously without unwanted gaps or breaks, unexpected gaps or breaks. On the other hand, non-fluent speech means it is like a car which is not able to run properly. It's like jerky movements. So speech is loaded with unwanted gaps and pauses. That is non-fluent speech. Rest of the things are not important. Like, I know the fluent speech may not be comprehensible. You may not be able to make sense of it. That is all secondary. That is not important for us. just to say whether it is fluent or not. Simply, when I say fluent, it means if there's a continuous flow from one word to another word. When I say non-fluent, it is broken. There is no continuous easy flow. You can say it is more labored. That is about fluency. The second thing we see is about comprehension. Now, comprehension is the perception of speech. Whether the patient understands the spoken information. If he can comprehend or understand what is being spoken to him, that means comprehension is normal. If he is not able to understand what is being spoken to him, that means the comprehension is impaired, right? So that was about fluency and comprehension. The third thing is repetition. The word itself gives out the idea, right? So you ask the patient to repeat something, that repeat after you. If he is able to repeat, good. Repetition is intact. If he is not able to repeat, it is impaired. The fourth one is naming. You pull out an object, give it to the patient and ask him to name it. Is he able to name it? Good. If he's not able to name it, naming is impaired. Now, don't show patient some medical equipment and ask him, like, don't show a patient a Ryle's tube and expect him to say that this is Ryle's tube. No, it's a common object, right? Show him a pen. If he identifies, good. If he doesn't identify, well, you expect everyone to identify a pen, right? Okay, so that is about naming. These four domains we're looking at. Now, Broca's, you guys already know, that means it is a motor aphasia. And Broca's area is the one which is affected. This is a motor aphasia. So remember one word. Whenever we talk about fluency, right? Whenever there is motor area involved, the fluency is usually lost. So there are three types of aphasias where the fluency is lost. Broca's aphasia, obviously, because I just told you the point, right? Whenever there is motor aphasia, motor involvement, fluency is lost. So there will be impaired fluency. The second aphasias where there is non-fluent speech is global aphasia. Now, what is global aphasia? Where both Broca's and Wernicke's areas are affected. All the domains of speech are affected. Fluency, comprehension, repetition, naming, everything is affected. That is global aphasia. So there is a motor component in that, right? So I told both Broca's and Wernicke's are affected. That means there is a motor component. Good. So in that case also, we will be expecting a non-fluent speech. The third one is something known as transcortical motor aphasia. So I did introduce you to the word transcortical, right? So this transcortical is divided into two types of transcortical aphasias, motor and sensory. Let me also add global aphasia to my list, right? So among these, now Broca's aphasia, then transcortical motor and the global, these three are going to have non-fluent speech. Okay, I hope you will be able to remember, because the motor system is involved. Motor regulation of the speech is, or the speech output is affected, so it is not going to be fluent. Okay, I hope you will be able to remember. Now, coming back to this slide. So, in Broca's, the fluency is impaired. We have a non-fluent speech. In Wernicke's, what is affected? The Wernicke's area, which is concerned with this perception of speech, sensory perception of speech, not the speech output, right? So, in Wernicke's, the fluency is normal. And trust me, you may not be surprised if the fluency is increased. Fluency can be normal or increased. You may ask me, sir, how does that increase? Well, it can increase because fluency, by definition, is what? Smooth flow from one word to another word. Right? So these Wernicke's people can sometimes have a better flow of words than what I am being able to produce now. Right? You might have noticed that I do stutter a little bit once in a while. That is like kind of human nature. Right? But these Wernicke's people may be like a TV presenter, perfect flow of smooth flow of words, right? Possible. So fluency in Wernicke's can be normal or increased. Then coming to comprehension. So in comprehension, Broca's aphasia, obviously the motor area which is affected, the sensory speech area is not affected. So comprehension is expected to be normal. You guys are very much familiar with this point, right? On the other hand, in Wernicke's, because the Wernicke's area is like ud gaya hai, it's gone. Obviously, the comprehension is going to be impaired. These two findings now are very, very clear to you. Fluency is mainly affected in Broca's area, Broca's aphasia, and the comprehension is mainly affected in Wernicke's aphasia. Now, coming to remaining two domains, repetition and naming. Repetition and naming are affected in both these major aphasias, two major aphasias. Repetition is impaired in both cases, naming is impaired in both cases. Okay, so the point is clear. So we are expecting from the four domains, three abnormalities in these major aphasias, right? So when we say Broca's, that means fluency, repetition and naming are affected, right? Fluency, repetition and naming are affected. In case of Wernicke's, again, three out of these four domains are affected. What are the ones which are affected? Comprehension is affected, repetition is affected, naming is affected. Right. So the two commonest aphasias, three out of four domains are affected. When all four are affected, we call it as global aphasia. Right? Now the point is clear. When all four are affected, fluency, comprehension, repetition, naming, all four are affected, we call it as global aphasia. Three affected should fit ideally into Broca's or Wernicke's. Right. So far it is clear. Now coming to conduction aphasia. Conduction aphasia. What happens in conduction aphasia? So conduction aphasia, repetition and naming, the two things which were affected in this two major kinds of aphasias, the two commonest types of aphasias, Broca's and Wernicke's, right? In them, repetition and naming were affected. So in conduction also, repetition and naming are affected. Okay, clear? So now we have three type of aphasias where the naming and repetition are both affected. Conduction, Broca's and Wernicke's. Okay, now you ask me what sets the conduction aphasia different from these. Well, in conduction aphasia, only these two domains are affected. I told you, three out of four domains are affected whenever I talk about Broca's or Wernicke's, right? Three out of four. So only one is spared in these cases. So in Wernicke's, what is spared? Fluency is spared. Fluency is spared in case of Wernicke's. And what is spared in case of Broca's? Comprehension is spared. It is unaffected. In case of conduction, it is like a conduction arcuate fasciculus. So it is not going to be as bad as these two major aphasias. So only two domains are affected, and those two domains are repetition and naming. Right. So now we know what is conduction aphasia. Right? So only repetition and naming are affected, fluency and comprehension are going to be normal. Fluency and comprehension are going to be normal. Clear? Okay. Now let me take you to this aphasia, anomic aphasia. So this is one area or one type of aphasia. Name itself gives out the clue. Right? Anomic means patient is unable to name something, and only one domain of these four speech areas that I spoke about is affected. That only naming is affected, right? So in this case, what all is preserved? Fluency is preserved, right? Repetition is preserved, and comprehension is preserved, right? All these three are preserved in case of anomic aphasia. So it's purely difficulty in naming. If you see the patient, you might find that these patients have little bit of pauses whenever they have to take a pause to find a word, because they have a naming abnormality, right? But otherwise, they speak fluently. They can comprehend whatever is being spoken to them, and they can repeat if you ask them to repeat after you. Right? That is anomic aphasia. So only one domain, right? So in conduction, two domains are affected, that is repetition and naming, which are like a blanketly affected domains, because they are also affected in Broca's as well as Wernicke's, right? So in Broca's and Wernicke's, three areas affected, two areas affected in case of conduction, one area affected in case of anomic. Now coming to the last area, four area affected obviously in case of global, right? When four affected, name says global. Now coming to transcortical aphasia, okay. This is something where I will again give you a clue which helps you to recognize. So transcortical is nothing but, so far, right, whatever we spoke about, except except anomic. The other three aphages I spoke about, repetition is impaired. It be it conduction, be it Broca's, be it Wernicke's, repetition is impaired. Right? But transcortical is an area where, so I know anomic repetition is preserved apart from that. Transcortical is a type of aphasia where the repetition is preserved. Okay. In the very beginning of the video, I had told you that there are two types of transcortical aphasias, right? Motor and sensory, right? Motor and sensory. So just imagine transcortical is nothing but transcortical is nothing but Broca's or Wernicke's with intact repetition. I will repeat it. Transcortical is nothing but Broca's or Wernicke's with intact repetition. What does that mean? Three ke badle mein now two domains will be affected in case of transcortical. So Broca's means we're expecting three domains to be affected: fluency, repetition, and naming. But what happens in transcortical motor? So those two things are there for transcortical, right? Transcortical motor, transcortical sensory. Transcortical motor means classic of motor is like fluency is impaired. So fluency is impaired. Comprehension is normal. Repetition is preserved. Naming is impaired. That is transcortical motor, right? So repetition, presence of repetition is like kind of a hallmark of, you can say, this is the hallmark of transcortical aphasias. So when you have a Broca's kind of aphasia, but repetition is preserved, that is transcortical motor aphasia. When you have a Wernicke's type of aphasia, but repetition is preserved, that is transcortical sensory aphasia. I hope the point is now clear, right? So we have two domains here affected, and repetition is intact. I want you to remember this point. Repetition is preserved. So simple way to remember this is either Broca's or Wernicke's with intact repetition. That is what is called as transcortical. So now I hope conceptually we will be able to understand these type of aphasias, right? So there is one table in Harrison which kind of summarizes whatever I have discussed. Right? So those who find it little more easier to follow through table, you can definitely go through this table. You can open up Harrison and it is well covered, or you can take a screenshot and you should be able to read it. Wernicke's, Broca's, global conduction, right? I told you transcortical anterior, which is also known as transcortical motor, transcortical posterior, which is also known as transcortical sensory aphasia, then anomic I have introduced you, and the pure word deafness. Pure word deafness is basically like where a situation, sensory speech area is affected, so patient is not able to comprehend the spoken language. The spoken language cannot be comprehended, but patient will be able to make sense. He can read and understand the language. He will be able to react to non-verbal sounds. He will identify a peacock making sound or a tiger making sound. He will be able to identify. Tell you that this is a tiger making a sound, or he will say snake is hissing. But when you try to talk to him, he will not be able to comprehend. So only the verbal communication, verbal comprehension is impaired, right? That is why we call this pure word deafness. Words, they can't comprehend. They can talk to you, they can verbalize efficiently, but they cannot interpret verbal communication made to them. That is what is known as pure word deafness. So in pure word deafness, impairment is only for the spoken language. When it comes to comprehension, impairment is restricted to spoken language. And because the comprehension of spoken language is impaired, repetition is also going to be impaired, because they are not understanding what are you telling them to repeat. So repetition is impaired, but naming is preserved. You show them a pen and ask them, what is it? Yeah, it is pen. They know it. Naming is preserved and fluency is preserved. When they spontaneously talk, they talk fluently. So that is pure word deafness. Okay. So these are the things I want you to remember. I hope I have made it a little more simpler for you to understand. For you to spend some time on this. Let me leave one speech disorder or speech abnormality. So here is a patient, right? So we have a patient with speech disorder, right? What is his speech abnormality? He is talking fluently, he speaks fluently, right? His communication or words are not comprehensible for us, he's speaking non-comprehensible words, he's speaking fluently, he's speaking non-comprehensible words, he's able to repeat, unable to name. So what is this speech abnormality? Right, fluent, non-comprehensible words, but able to repeat, unable to name. Right, so I have already told you that when it is non-fluent, I would think of a motor involvement, Broca's, global and transcortical motor. I would be thinking of these three when the speech is non-fluent. In this case, it is fluent, right? The first thing that should come to my mind is Wernicke's, where there is fluent speech. Otherwise, anomial, right? Or the pure word deafness. These are the three where there is fluent speech. In this case, let me see if it fits into any of them. So, speech is fluent. Is it Wernicke's? He is unable to name. Yeah, that kind of goes in favor of possibly Wernicke's, right? But he's able to repeat. So in case of Wernicke's, what are we expecting? In case of Wernicke's, I'm expecting that the patient is not able to comprehend. Patient's comprehension is lost. Anyway, in this question description, they have not told anything about comprehension. This non-comprehensible words, as I was telling you, it is about I am unable to understand what patient is talking. Okay. Anyway, they have not mentioned anything about comprehension. Let us set that aside. The second thing that we are expecting in Wernicke's is it is going to be fluent speech, right? Fluent speech, that is there here. The speech is fluent. The third thing we are anticipating in case of Wernicke's as well as Broca's as well as conduction is those two standard domains which are affected, which is repetition. And the other one is naming, right? So in this case, patient is unable to name, so that satisfies the criteria. But repetition is present, which goes against the diagnosis of Wernicke's. Now I told you, right? Wernicke's or Broca's, where repetition is intact. If it is like typically fitting into Wernicke's with intact repetition, or typically fitting into Broca's with intact repetation. Teen ke badle mein two domains affected, what is that? It is transcortical, right? So here it is fluent, that means it is transcortical sensory, right? So this case fits into transcortical sensory aphasia. Okay, so one example. Let us take one more example. So here we have a patient who neither speaks, reduced speech output, doesn't speak, not able to comprehend anything. So what am I talking about? Obviously, global aphasia. Comprehension lost, output lost, global aphasia. Okay, then here we have a patient who is having a fluent speech, is able to strike a conversation on his own. He is able to comprehend what I tell and respond appropriately, but he cannot name objects. So what am I talking about? I'm talking about anomial aphasia. Okay, so here is another patient who has no hearing deafness, but whatever I'm trying to tell him, he's not able to understand. But spontaneously, he talks to me. He asks questions or he's trying to talk to me. He identifies the non-verbal sounds. He is able to identify and relate to them. Yet his speech is also fluent. Whenever he's talking spontaneously, his speech is fluent. So what am I talking about? I'm talking about pure word deafness, right? Okay, we have one more patient who is having reduced speech output, means he is talking less. Okay, so he is having a non-fluent speech, broken speech, non-fluent speech. Right? But whatever I tell him, he's able to understand. I tell him to get up, he's getting up. I tell him to sleep, he's sleeping. So he understands. So comprehension of the spoken language is present. But the output is reduced and it is not fluent. It is a broken speech. Okay. When I ask him to repeat, he's not able to do. When I ask him to name something, he's not able to do. So which speech disorder I'm talking about? I said non-fluent, right? Non-fluent, and these two domains are already affected, repetition and naming. So I'm talking about Broca's aphasia. Right? So I have already given you an example of a transcortical sensory aphasia. If the same patient which I told you in just a minute back, if someone who is having non-fluent speech, unable to repeat, unable to name the objects, if I just tell you that this person is able to repeat, then I'm talking about transcortical motor aphasia. So now I hope that all kinds of aphasias are very, very clear to you. So every alternate year or once in 3 years or once in two exams, like if you take one calendar year, there will be one question about aphasia, like that important this topic it is. So do spend some time with Harrison's table and try to see if that makes sense to you. If you're finding it really difficult, I will be posting this PPT on one of my Telegram groups and you can pick it up from there. Okay. Thank you guys. I'll connect you on another video about similar important conceptual topics. Thank you.